Today on Between the Lines, the story of an epic business battle with Richard Skip Bronson. Welcome, I'm Barry Kibrick. Richard is the chairman and founder of US Digital Gaming and one of the nation's leading commercial real estate developers. But for a number of years, he was at the center of a clash of two business tycoons, Donald Trump and Steve Wynn. With his book, The War at the Shore, Skip Bronson gives us the inside scoop of the true battle for a boardwalk empire.
I'm a writer today because I was a reader when I was 11 years old. And it was...
You do not need to prove your state of happiness to anybody.
Most of these speeches were as much as a month in preparation.
Characters, the heroes in this book, are seekers of truth in a story that involves a lot of corruption.
I don't get a chance to really talk about what's real. And it's the perfect thing to do.
Skip, I want to let everyone know it's Richard Skip Bronson, but you like to be known as Skip, so Skip, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Barry.
It's my pleasure. You know, this book is about this battle at the shore between two epic personalities, Steve Wynn and Donald Trump. But yet, while reading it, the one I'm amazed at is you, because how you have to deal with all of the things, and we're going to get into each one of them. Those guys are bleeding out orders a little bit. I'm not putting anyone down that's, Steve sounds like a wonderful man, and even Donald in here, when you find out you make peace, no besmirching of either one. But what you have to deal with seemed beyond the call of duty all the time.
It was challenging, no doubt, we had this epic battle. And it was very interesting because the two personalities are so big, they are so outsized, that when you're dealing with people of this ilk, I have to say it does take a certain skill set to be able to try to keep them focused and try to never lose sight of the fact that you have to keep your eye on the prize. The most important thing is you have to keep your eye on the prize and try not to be distracted by all the histrionics, all the drama that takes place.
A line you give us before you decide, two things I want to go over, before you decide to get involved with Steve Wynn, and briefly to let the viewers know, this is, I'll say it in the introduction, this is literally a battle in Atlantic City, because Steve, who already was making money in Atlantic City, backed out, and he was very upset that he didn't see the money trickle down to the people, and Trump at this time owns most of the casinos going on there, and Steve wants to come back in. So that's sort of the setup. But before he recruits you, you say this thing, because I guess you came out of your own business at the time, and you say, looking back at yourself before working for Steve, the most valuable asset I possessed was the urgent certainty that I had to reinvent myself, and fast. That's an important lesson for everyone to heed.
Well, you know, it's interesting. As you get older and you've had some accomplishments in your life, one of my favorite Steve Wynn quotes is when he says, "Please God, may I not be embarrassed." You know, I think you reach a certain point when you've reached a certain level of success in terms of your business career, creating money. And at that point, you just want to make sure that you don't do anything to embarrass yourself. I've got, in my office in Beverly Hills, I have a wall of quotes. People love it. When you first walk into the reception area and then all the way down through the hallway, I have all of these quotes that I've collected literally over a lifetime. And one of Donald's quotes is on the wall. And Donald's quote that's on the wall is, "It doesn't matter." And actually, that quote matters to really understand the man, because Donald and I were at a Laker game sitting on the floor, and they had Donald's picture up on the Diamond Vision inside the arena in the Staples Center, and people were cheering when they saw his face. He was there with his big bright yellow tie, and he had that big toothy smile, and a lot of people were also booing. And later we got in the car and I said, "You know, I have to ask you this question. When those people were booing, how did that make you feel?" And he said, "Doesn't matter. Really doesn't matter." And it's an amazing quality that a guy like Donald Trump has. And in great order, a quality that Steve Wynn has, that it really doesn't matter. They don't get hung up on how people think about them. They care about what they're doing. They care about how their work is perceived. But personally, the way they are personally perceived really doesn't disturb them. However, no one wants to be, quote, embarrassed. Of course, we all have a different sort of gauge as to what's embarrassing and what isn't.
You know, you said you collect quotes on your wall. I was going to start with this next one because this was by Robert Strauss. And it was you deciding whether or not you should take this immense task on. And I love this one. You don't quit. And this is what he says. He says, while you're wrestling a gorilla, because these men are gorillas, they're titans. He says, when you wrestle a gorilla, you don't quit when you're tired. You quit when the gorilla's tired. And I just thought, wow.
Well, that's so true because, you know, the gorilla will eat you if you quit. So quitting is not in my lexicon. You know, one of the reviews of the book, someone used the word indefatigable. I mean, the fact is, if I do have a really strong work ethic that probably comes from my mother, it is that I don't give up. I mean, there were so many opportunities to give up when we were fighting this fight over Atlantic City, when we were, Steve and I were trying to, of course, just for context, Steve and I were trying to develop a multi-billion dollar project. It was Donald's backyard. It was his sandbox. He didn't want us there and did everything humanly possible to keep us from going there. It would have been easy to walk away. It would have been easy to just say, you know what, why bother? Let's go find something else to do. But we managed to fight through that and stay on point, and as I said earlier, kept our eye on the prize and kept working to get to where we wanted to be.
I laugh a little bit because your wife, is it Edie or Eddie? How does she?
Edie.
Edie, your wife Edie, she says to you, because she knows who you are, and she says, you know, Skip, it's not over till it's over, but when it's over, it's over. And I could, she was just as fed up and as frustrated about what was going on.
Well, I think for those of us that are in these confrontations, we get so engrossed in what we're doing, we don't really take the time to examine not only how it's affecting us, but how it's affecting those around us. Because if you're involved in something that you are just totally locked in, drilled down, and on it 24/7, you probably lose sight of how the people around you feel about it and how they're impacted and the fact that they're worried about you. But when you're in it, you know, you just there's that laser beam like focus, and if you don't have that laser focus, you can't win.
Well, you say even that if you don't, it's in fact the talent you say that's required is to convey your ideas to other people quickly and clearly. That cannot be done without laser focus. You can't be, because first of all, things are coming at you in situations like this, and we'll get into them, that you couldn't even fathom or expect. So you have to be able to be laser focused and be able to be flexible while being constant, a very difficult task.
You have to always assume that they are going to prevail, or you have to assume that they're going to fight and they're going to do whatever they have to do to try to win. If you underestimate them, you've made a huge mistake. So I've never underestimated the opposition.
Also, you say when you describe all the other requirements, it is still passion, that you still must feel this passion for what you're doing and know that there's a goodness behind it, because you really can't feel passion, because passion also means to struggle as well. You can't endure that unless you really feel that there's a higher purpose, there's a cause involved here.
Well, that and the fact you can't teach drive. You either have it or you don't have it. You either have that passion, you have that drive to succeed. You know, my mother was a very tough taskmaster, and I wasn't a great student. I was smart, but not a great student. I always found school to be sort of a pain. I wanted to go off and make my own mark and do things, and school didn't really appeal to me all that much. And I came home once, I was 11 years old, and I brought home a science exam, and it had an A. I received an A. And I gave it to my mother, and she picked it up and she looked at the piece of paper and she said, "Was there a higher grade available?" Oh. She literally, it was, you just had to do better. You had to be perfect. And, you know, of course, none of us can be perfect.
Heard me laugh because, you know what, I thought you were going to tell the story about when you brought home the wrong rye bread.
Oh, wow.
Because, holy mackerel, you thought an A was good. Your mom made you go out in a blizzard because she brought home a round rye bread rather than a long rye bread.
Exactly. Yeah, my mother wanted a long rye bread without seeds sliced. And God forbid you brought home that had caraway seeds in it. You were in a lot of trouble. And she literally, in a blizzard, sent me back to the bakery to get her the rye bread that she wanted. And as the baker said, he said to me, you can tell the difference between a round rye and a long rye? I said, no, but obviously my mother can.
Now, I'll tell you, though, that toughness, though, that's required, this comes not as a shock, unfortunately, to me, but the role of government. My first guest ever on this show was Mario Puzo. Mm. And I'll never forget when we were talking about his book at that time, The Last Don, he said, you know, all you people think the mafia and the Vegas people, we're the criminals. We're the ones that are corrupting. He says, wait till you have to deal with the government.
Really?
And nothing comes out clearer in this story between these two men, because it's really their battle, but the role that government plays, and literally not in a very delightful way. Let me leave it at that.
Right. My first lesson, just to confirm what you said, was in Hartford, Connecticut, when Steve and I wanted to develop a casino resort in my hometown of Hartford, Connecticut. And I didn't know anything about the political process. I was a real estate developer, so the only political involvement I had was dealing with local zoning boards, trying to get the local zoning changed, but never anything in terms of state government. And I had to go to the state capitol and try to convince legislators why it would be a good idea to legalize casino gambling in Hartford, Connecticut, that would allow Steve Wynn to come and develop a $1 billion hotel, resort, convention center, et cetera. And I was told that there was a particular state senator that I had to meet with because he was going to be chairing the committee that would be discussing this topic. And I went to see him and I started to talk to him and he said to me, well, hold on, who's sponsoring the bill? And I said, Senator DiBella is the sponsor. And he said, oh, really? Yeah. Well, you know what? He said, he screwed me on trash to energy, so you can forget about this and be sure you tell him I said so. And I walked out in the hallway and said to myself, what just happened? What happened? He didn't want to hear about the jobs that would be created. He didn't want to hear about the tax revenue. He didn't want to hear about the huge crowds that we could bring to re-energize the city. He was only focused on the fact that there was another politician who apparently did him dirty on something. And that was the big precedent. That was what it was. And I learned an amazing lesson at that very moment. I can remember like it was yesterday. That was my real introduction to how the political process works.
Oh, you said something that I think sums it up so beautifully. You said, you know, the symbols of the parties are not the donkey or the elephant. It's the upturned palm. Yeah. And that's what you've noticed and the irony of it is not so much in Vegas, where you'd expect corruption more than you would in other places. But you saw it in New Orleans. You saw it in Jersey. You saw it in Connecticut. You saw it where, you know, you wouldn't think of it necessarily. And it was literally, it was disgusting to read about it.
Well, you know, Connecticut has the highest per capita income in the nation. And it's thought of as a preppy, even waspy place, you know, and a gentrified place. Has some of the most corrupt politicians in the country. I mean, countless mayors and other legislators have gone to prison. Governor Rowland went to prison for corruption. And that's in Connecticut. So as you say, some of us have this thought that, well, maybe in other states. And unfortunately, people who are corrupt no matter what state they're in. And the political process is critically important in casino development because A, it's a controversial subject. It's not as controversial as it once was, but back in the day, it was like abortion or the death penalty. People are very passionate about the gambling business. As I say, less so now that there are casinos in roughly 40 states. But it's still something that gets people very uptight about in certain circles. And it also, it requires you to change laws. So as I've said to people in my office, if we decided to go across the street and open a restaurant, you just go across the street, you negotiate a lease, you find a chef, you open up a restaurant. In the casino business, you have to typically, you have to change the law to allow you to go into the business. And whenever you're changing laws and you're deeply enmeshed in this political process, you do so at your own peril.
That's the sense. These guys, they just go forward. Yeah. They are never stopped. It doesn't matter what happens.
Absolutely.
They look at, and in fact, in almost all greatness, whether it's in business, whether it's in sports, especially in sports, you can see it is, you've got to let that, you struck out, you can't let that bother you the next time. You missed that putt, you can't, you got to be able to accept it and move on.
These are the most half full glass guys that you can find. They're thoroughly optimistic, forward thinking, always moving ahead, now they're not like teenage boys who don't consider the consequences of their actions. They do consider the consequences, but they're always looking ahead. The next deal, move on, move forward, keep going ahead, and not sitting back and wondering, what if this happens? What if I don't do this? What if I don't do that? It's just a forward-thinking mentality.
And it's not just money. People don't realize it. I was amazed to see when you discussed about Steve, you could have had something easy. One of the things that goes on here is you want to build a tunnel in Vegas, and it does cause a little bit of eminent domain, which, by the way, in Atlantic City, and it does cause a little issues with eminent domain, and you are very sensitive to the fact that property is such an important element to an individual. But in this particular case, Steve could have literally gave $100 million or so to the government. That's what they literally wanted, a check from him or cash. And he could have afforded it, but he really had a mantra, and that was that, listen, we'll take the risk of building businesses to bring people to your city to, you know, employ the people of your city, but the government must take care of its own infrastructure. So even though he could have had an easy pass, for him at that time, the $100 million to the government would have been an issue, it was a moral principle. And it's interesting to see that even when you're dealing with such tough businessmen, and by the way, I mean, Donald is doing stuff to Steve that you wouldn't do to your worst enemy, but they still have a certain level of where we're not going to mess with. And Steve was very particular about that.
Yeah, Steve has always believed that government must create the infrastructure, create the canvas, if you will, so the artist can come in and paint the painting. But it's up to government to provide that canvas. And Steve was saying, wait a second, there are transportation issues in Atlantic City that need to be taken care of whether I ever come here or not. This really doesn't have anything to do with me. This has to do with the fact that you cannot properly access certain areas of the city from the existing road network unless you create a new road network. So our thought was the only way we were going to be able to get the customers from the Atlantic City Expressway out to this remote piece of land initially, and I don't talk about this in the book, but initially the first thought was maybe we would build a bridge. But a bridge would have been even more disruptive. One of the reasons that we opted for a tunnel was it would be less disruptive, but it did require taking out 9 homes in a middle-class black neighborhood. So there were racial overtones to this. You touched on the fact that when you take someone's home away from them, it's something very sacred about someone's home. And there are people, as you well know, that they don't care how much you offer them for their home. They don't want you to take their house. But we would not have an interstate highway system in America if not for the fact that government has to have the right to be able to do that through eminent domain.
You give us a lesson here that I wasn't aware of, and that's called the price of money. And nowhere is it clearer than when we hear all the time on the radio about the rates, the interest rates, whatnot. But when you're dealing, like you said, with such slight margins, the price of money that is required that you guys, no matter how wealthy you are, have to borrow to still build what you need to build, those percentages are vastly different, and who can get that is going to have an upper hand.
Right. The cost of money is more important than the cost of concrete. the cost of money is more important than the cost of steel. The cost of the money is a critical element in any real estate development deal. One of the advantages that we're facing today in these certain in these uncertain economic times is the fact that money is very inexpensive today. Back in the day when we were working on this project, it wasn't as inexpensive as it is today, and it was an even bigger consideration then than it is today. Today, everybody sort of assumes that money is fairly inexpensive in terms of borrowing.
You know, as a developer, you give us some insight into what is required, and you say the rules of the business. Rule one, there are no rules. Rule two, in case of disputes or difficulties, see rule one. I don't know why. Mm-hmm. Nothing comes out clearer in this book than that. A, there's no rules. And then when things get tough, go back to rule one. There's no rules. Just go nuts. I mean, literally.
Well, another thing I talk about in the book is when I was a developer in Connecticut and I developed the regional office for McDonald's, a gentleman by the name of Frank Behan was the